Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to changing the world of work so that more organizations can be more effective and less dysfunctional, and employees can be more fulfilled and less miserable. I'm your host, Patrick Lencioni, and I'm joined, as always, by Cody Thompson, my co-host. How you doing, Cody?
Loving it. Great.
Good.
I say great all the time. I tried to change it. It didn't work, but I'll go with loving it.
But we're great because Tracy's back. Tracy Noble, how you doing,
hey
Tracy?
Hey there. I'm great.
It's good to have you here. We also have Matthew off mic, I think, our engineer. How you doing, Matt? Matt nods. That's great. Okay. What we're going to talk about today, Cody, what's our title?
The title is, with our good friend Southwest, Want to Get Away.
That's right. That's right. That comes from the Southwest Airlines slogan. They're not paying us for this, but everybody knows that, Want to Get Away. In this case, what we're talking about is the need for teams to get away, to have offsite meetings, which is one of the four meetings we think people should have, the offsite quarterly or every once in a while. And now it's been a year since many people have even been to their offices. Now, some of us have been working in our offices, but there's a lot of people out there still who have not been in their office with their colleagues for a year. And while we can debate the merits of that from a legal standpoint or from a healthcare or constitutional perspective, that's not what we're here to do. We're here with a more specific point, and that's that teams need time together to maintain, restore, and build trust. And I think right now, if you had to look at teams, you'd have to say that teamwork is sagging in our society, which is understandable. But there's a limit to what people can do virtually, and the cost of not taking time to meet in person is really high. All of this means that finding a way to meet with your team right now in person could actually present you with a real opportunity for competitive advantage. And that's what we want to talk about today.
That's right. And it actually makes all the sense in the world as it relates to how we think about teamwork. Is if the basis of teamwork is around building, you know, interpersonal vulnerability-based trust, then that's getting increasingly hard to do in a world where people are on Zoom every day, where it's tilted in the scales of like efficiency. And so teams that aren't doing this, if they haven't already felt this, a year into it, it's going to get really bad.
Yeah, I think the fatigue of just like, wow, we really haven't seen one another. Now, there's a bunch of different reasons for this. And some people are going to say, hey, my team has been doing it. And we get that. We want to talk about why that's so important. Other people are going to say, my company doesn't allow us to, or it's kind of frowned on. And then there's some leaders that are probably like, and I talk about this in the book, The Motive, I don't really like doing this anyway, so it's kind of nice to have a reprieve from having to do offsite meetings.
Like a hall pass, like a built-in excuse.
Exactly. But the truth is we can only go so long without actually physically being together. And not just to go back to work. What we're talking about is the offsite meeting to recharge, to reestablish our commitment to one another, to the mission, and to, you know, my friend Matthew Kelly says, to have carefree timelessness together.
And that's necessary to restore intimacy and trust with your team.
Right.
We have to do this. You know, last week I was actually on vacation and I went away with my husband and my sister and her husband.
And you didn't go to across the world. You
no,
just drove 30 miles
we
away.
We drove 30 miles. And let me tell you, that transformed the relationship I have with my husband, the relationship I have with my sister and brother-in-law. It was wild. We had not spent time together in a year. Now I live with Greg. And we spend every day together, but it's amazing the excuses we make when we're in the routine mm-hmm. of our day-to-day lives. And I feel so much better about our relationship. It's just, it was incredible.
Well, and it's crazy because in a microcosm, I mean, even it's, we do tend to just focus on what's in front of us and try to get stuff done. And like Lindsay and I, we didn't go away, but we went to dinner. You know, we got away for 3
well,
hours
when you have
from
little
kids
yeah. like you, that's like a
well,
offsite
but,
meeting.
But it was a similar experience because you we're busy changing diapers and making sure
exactly.
things are going in the home. And even spending, you know, an hour, 90 minutes at a dinner and having different conversations. I mean, that's what teams are missing out on when they aren't taking time to quarterly or even in the last year to step back and go, what's going on?
You know what's interesting? Even teams that are working like us are reluctant now to do offsites.
Yeah, we haven't done one in months.
And it's like, why is that? And it's kind of because, well, the world's kind of shut down. I mean, and it's not really, but you can go get a room at a hotel and have a day-long meeting.
Right.
Or you can go do something. And we're just, I think we're probably out of shape when it comes to that kind of meeting.
I think your point early on about the leader sort of taking this as an excuse is one of the reasons for sure, because it's harder. It doesn't mean just because it's harder, it's not necessary. In fact, it's more necessary now than it's been in a
right.
long time. And so we've even heard stories of our consultants, you know, there are more and more teams that are out there getting together, but they will get together in an auditorium and, you know, so and right. there are ways to do it. It's just going to be a little bit more difficult. And I think it is, in fact, a competitive advantage right now. The teams that actually will take time to do this, as opposed to the ones who are like, we're just going to grind this out for as long as we can on Zoom. You're going to be at the end of a year, call it 18 months, whatever it is, and realize that the foundation of your team is eroding.
You know, it's funny. I talked to a friend this over the weekend, and he's in insurance. He's been at this big, huge insurance company. They just announced they're going to close all their field offices. Hmm. And so anybody that doesn't work at headquarters, and he said like there's 30 people in his area here that used to work in an office, they're just going to stop doing that. And I don't think people realize the cost that's going to have. And what I mean by that is this, they need to still do offsites. They still need to get together. And I don't care if they do it at a restaurant or they rent out a room someplace, but they'll probably stop doing that and assume that they can shift to Zoom or virtual meetings. So I think we're going to go through something in our society probably that hasn't happened in years and years. And that is we're going to see a retreat from people being closer together and working together, and we're going to miss something. Mm-hmm. And so my advice to people listening is whether your team is already working together, get out and do offsites. And even if you're not working together day to day, go find a way to get together at a hotel.
Right.
Go do an offsite meeting, drive 10 miles to do this, because the benefits are great. And right now we're almost getting too used to the fact that we don't do it anymore.
Well, I think what's interesting is this is the conversation we've had for years and years and years with companies in different packaging. And that is, it really comes down to smart versus healthy. You know, like it really comes down to whether we think companies can succeed, that the measure of success is going to be on the smart side, which is how good can we do remote work, or we need a better plan for getting more out of our people when they're working from home, and totally ignore the healthy side, which is minimum politics, minimal confusion, high morale, high productivity, great teams and culture. And you can't do that without getting people together. It feels to me, even as we're having this conversation, Pat, like every CEO we've ever talked to is, this is the same conversation in different packages.
You know, it's funny. I think organizational health, people have been recognizing how important it is. I think we're going to find ourselves taking two big steps back.
Yeah.
Because people are like, yeah, we don't need that. We can cut this much cost. And so why are people doing that? Are they stupid? No, I think that they're afraid. Mm-hmm. And they're afraid of legal, of getting sued, which is so disproportionate to the reality. Nobody is advocating to do something unsafe. But I think we've gotten to this idea that we don't want to do anything. I talked to a guy last week, the head of a company, and he said, well, we just can't make our people come back to work. And well, at some point, we're going to say that's what it means to work here. But we just said, well, what about just giving people permission to get together if they want to? Mm-hmm. And people are like, oh, we don't even want to do that.
Yeah.
So think about how we're denying one of the fundamental tenets of teamwork and healthy organizations, that people need to see each other sometimes.
Right.
And if there's an exception, a person has a problem that they can't do that, fine, but don't bring the entire organization or the entire team down because of an outlier.
And I think it's funny. I remember a podcast we had done a while ago, and it was, we were going to title it either We're Crazy or You're Crazy. And it was about, the reason we get so passionate about this is this is fundamentally core to what we believe about business and human beings. You know, like that you need to spend time together. And so it is frustrating. It gets frustrating to go like, oh no, we're just going to strip that part out of it and continue to operate. You know, it's like
the most fundamental part.
It'd be that we're human beings. You know what? Let me go home and tell my wife that, hey, you know what? We're just going to do our marriage by Zoom from here on out. It's a little more efficient and we can stay in our own rooms and we'll figure out how to deal with the kids. It's like, no, you're ripping out the core component of this that actually makes things work. And you can't do that.
Right. And remember, the word company is Latin for breaking bread. Mm-hmm. And we need to do that sometimes.
And most of us want to work with other people. For me, to sit behind a computer screen every day, day in and day out, sounds so miserable. And I think most people want to come back to work, and these companies just aren't recognizing that.
Right. And again, there's ways to do this safely, legally. I think it's almost become a self-imposed restriction. I really do. And then when you have the added of like, well, maybe we can cut costs as we're doing this. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to wake up in 3 years. And for the companies that are not afraid, they're going to have a huge advantage over the ones that
are. Yeah. And I think that's an interesting point. It's like, generally, we're motivated by fear or reward, right? Which is like, oh, if I feel like half the time we're screaming like, no, the rewards are there. You need to go do this, you know? And that you might be motivated by the fact that, hey, if you don't go do this, then your competitors, the other companies, the talent is going to go elsewhere. You know, right. Like that your business might not be as resilient as it has been.
Tracy, you just said your son just took a job, which is awesome. Tell us about how he decided.
So my son is interviewing right now. He's graduating college and he's interviewing for positions. And one of the companies said to him, you have the option to stay home or come into the office. And the other one said, oh no, you have to come into the office, that we're a small company. This is just the way we work. He selected the company where he has to go into the office because he craves that. He's a new college grad. He wants to work with people. He wants to learn from people. And I love that. I love that he selected the smaller company.
You know, and Matt, who's sitting here, he's not on mic, but he most of your friends, right, have not been into the office at all. So you graduated college almost a year ago. And a lot of these guys, their whole idea of work is, I've never actually been in person with the people I work with.
Right.
And again, there's creative ways to do this so that people can feel connected. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge part of this. And I think it's going to be a competitive advantage in hiring. I think it's going to be a competitive advantage in productivity, certainly. And I think over the long term, it's just going to be the bottom line.
Well, it does. I kind of shudder at the idea of what this looks like in 5 years if we don't, if more and more companies don't get this message. You know, like, it's funny, I graduated in, you know, my master's program in 2008. So there were no jobs. And then, and now we're facing a whole different reality, which is there's jobs, but you don't get to go to work, you know?
Right.
And more and more people, I think, you know, we had done that whole podcast on virtual productivity. And I think your son might be the anomaly that's like, hey, I want to get in there. I think half the college students are like, I can play Call of Duty in the morning and then I can go work for a little bit in the afternoon.
We disagree on this. Yeah. I think the majority, I think there are a lot of people.
Too. Yeah. I think they've just given in and said, well, and because they've never known.
Exactly.
And so I actually think none of these kids are bragging like, hey, I don't have to go to work. I can play Call of Duty. They're complaining.
Yeah.
Because when they talk to their friends, they're like, oh no, I get to go meet with people. I think that though, I can understand where you're coming from, but I think people are like, this sucks.
Well, I hope that's true because otherwise I'm worried.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I think what we need to recognize is that we are right now in a teamwork drought. Mm-hmm. I think we are probably at a very low point in terms of teamwork in our society for understandable reasons. And so, but we need to get some water in here so things will grow again. And so be the first on your block to do that.
Right.
Find a way to have an offsite. I don't care if it's 5 miles away or 50 miles away, or for Southwest Airlines' sake, you can fly. You know, it's so funny. I'm always a little puzzled by the fact that we will get on a plane with 150 people, sit on a plane for 4 hours with people right next to you. Granted, we're wearing masks, but it's in recycled air. But then 10 people will not agree to go sit in a hotel room 6 feet apart and get to know each other again. And this get to know each other again is really important because, you know, one of the things we talk about is in the three signs of a miserable job or in job fulfillment, we say that you have to know each other, anonymity. And yes, for the first 6 months or 3 months on Zoom, we were staying in touch with each other. But I can tell you that when all I do is Zoom with somebody, I just kind of repeat the same question. So how's the baby or how's this? But when we're in a room together for an extended period of time, we go deeper.
Right.
Well, and you have to be it. In order to build that trust, that vulnerability-based trust, you have to be in the same room with one another. I mean, it's impossible to do otherwise day in and day out. You know, you can do it for a while, but it's not sustainable.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting. I mean, we got married and moved into a home and did transition jobs all at the same time. And during that process, I was reading a book where there was like a psychologist who attached a number value to changes in your life that happen and say like, oh, if they add up to a certain point, this
don't
is where
married,
you could
have
be.
A baby, build a house, take a new job.
Right. But when you think of that in the context of what this year has been for most people, it's like, even if the people you saw in the office a year ago have dramatically different lives now, or have faced a bunch of different things, both internally and in their families and homes that we don't know about, that often doesn't come up. It's like people's lives are so different that when you say get to know each other again, it's like, this is like reconnecting to a high school, you know, like a high school friend or something. I think the whole world has changed in many cases. And so that spending some time going there and not just getting on a Zoom call that has a agenda item attached to it and a PowerPoint and zooming through those versus like taking some time back. So it's part vulnerability and team building. But I also think the other part that's more on the strategic side is you have different conversations, you know, And you talked about that with your husband. It's like, how often do we skip the meaningful conversations when we're in our daily routines? But when you have some time to step back, you start, the nature of your conversations change.
You know what I saw the other day? It was so interesting, Cody. You just reminded me of this by what you said. And that is that Citigroup, the CEO of Citigroup, she decided that people are having Zoom fatigue. And so they outlawed Zoom on Fridays at their company. And I thought it was the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. Because, I mean, the reason why people have Zoom fatigue is because they're not together. So to say, you can't do that anymore, she might as well just say, and you can't use your phone. It's like, get people together safely. They want, they yearn for human contact. And Zoom is better than nothing.
Right.
But when we talk about Zoom fatigue, yeah, we're staring at a screen. But so what they're saying is, so now I want you to shut that down and sit by yourself for some time.
Well, and that's the point, is like, when you're operating at a deficit, cutting out some of that doesn't fill you back up. If people's, if and I think that's the message too, is like, if you don't believe your team is operating at a deficit right now, you're wrong.
Right.
That they need human contact. They need to be brought together to realign around the priorities and realign around the relationships. And so—
And you can do it safely. Yep. You can do it legally. But it's going to take a little bit of courage, and your people are going to go, thank you for doing that. Harrison, your son, was not like, oh, you're going to make me come to work. I can't believe. He was like, oh, thank you. I want to get to know these people, and I want to have a great job experience. So, and if you do need to fly, Southwest is probably a pretty good way to get cheap tickets to go
someplace.
They're
like $29 right now.
But do the want to get away fare, yeah, and that's cheaper.
Exactly.
So that's a tribute to Southwest Airlines, a very healthy organization. Thanks, you guys, for being here. Thanks, Matt. And that's the end of our podcast day. We'll look forward to seeing you next time on At the Table. God bless.